Hello everyone, and welcome to today's art chat with Linda Fisler, Creating Color Relationships in Harmony with George Gallo. My name is Sarah Alfa. I'll be your moderator here. I will be here to take your questions. If you have questions for Linda or George, please type them into the question section of your GoToWebinar control panel, and I will relay those on to them on your behalf. Also, we are recording today's art chat, and we will send out a link to that later today. It'll be up on our YouTube. So if you know somebody who wasn't able to join us, feel free to share that with your friends or your social networks. And finally, we have some special discounts and a special kit from George to tell you about. And all of that will be coming at the end of today's art chat, so stick around for that. And it'll also be in the follow-up email coming your way later today. All right, so welcome, Linda and George. I'll let you guys take it away.
Hi, everyone. Hi, George.
Hello.
You know, I just don't get enough of you regular-wise, so we just have to keep having you on Art Chat. You know that?
It sounds great. I'll be on every week. I'm happy to do it.
Yeah, but I only...
This week's special guest, same as last week's special guest.
Yeah, good. That'll be really good.
Yeah.
No, you know, we're always glad to have you on the show and always enjoy talking with you.
Happy to do it.
Yeah. So, well, let's start off with a little bit of house cleaning, if you will. I know that you are on early with us in the month because you are going to be heading over to Tucson, Arizona for the Plein Air Conference.
Yeah, next week. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You're demoing there?
Yeah, I'm the opening act, I guess. It's opening night. There's, in the auditorium, I'll be doing a... it's pretty funny that I'm showing how to paint a large canvases quickly, because that's one of the things I do is I can paint small ones. I can also paint very large ones outdoors, and how to, think quick, put it down, don't second guess it and move on. So I'll be doing a large demo on stage.
Yeah. And by large, you mean larger than 16 by 20.
Yeah, I mean, they've only given me an hour and a half to do it, so I don't think I'll go much bigger than 36-48 is what I'm thinking.
There you go.
I think bigger than that, I'm asking, I'll never get it done in time, but, you know, the difference between doing a 16 by 20 on location and a 36 by 48 on location is instead of just moving your wrist, you're moving your arm and your body, but you're still making design choices and color choices. You're just painting a lot bigger
and you use bigger brushes.
Yes, I mean it's all sort of scale and ratio, but what I like about it is, as I said in my book, I don't advocate that every painting you do outside is like the size of a sailboat, sail on a sailboat, but I think it can free you up in a way because you can't get precious when you're painting that large. And that was a we've talked about this in the past. There was a Edward Redfield used to do that, and he said when he was painting lots of small ones, he used to get tight, and the best way he knew how to free up was to try to execute a large painting in about 3 hours, and it was a great way to loosen up.
Right. Well, and it's true too, because a lot of my students in my classes start small, and I keep trying to encourage them to start large. And then when they move from their small canvas to the large canvas, they go, I think it's easier to paint larger. And I'm like, you think?
Yeah, it can be because, and again, I think it forces you to be smart, and there's a lot of color temperature shifts inside of large masses that you can't really do on a small canvas, like a big group of trees, if you're looking at them, let's say you're like along a stream or something and you're painting larger, if you look into that tree mass, you'll notice a lot of different color temperature and value shifts that are a lot of fun to paint, and again, if you're doing a smaller painting, you're just doing a couple of brush strokes to express that, as opposed to really getting into the nitty gritty of it. Again, I mean, if you look at the great masters, okay, you look at all impressionist masters, be they the French or any of the European guys, or any of the American impressionists that came, almost like a generation later. If you look at any any of those masters, they all did important work. They did large paintings, and it has to be part of your repertoire. You can't really just do like little, you know, 8x12s the rest of your life, you know, and you're never going to grow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's my story. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Sound good. Yeah. But we're here to talk actually color.
Okay.
We talked about anybody who wants to hear about how George paints live, plein air, out on large canvases, go to the Art Chat Library on my website, lindafisler.com, and you'll see our other talks with George where we cover a lot about that. So, but today I wanted to talk a lot about color because, you know, George, I call you a color expressionist, a colorist, whatever you want to do that with. I love your color and your painting. And
thank you.
We want to talk and chat about that a little bit. When we talked before this, you said naturally understanding color, a lot of it has to do with understanding values. So
that's correct.
Let's talk a little bit about that. Why? Tell us about value and why you think that is important to understand.
Well, there's an old expression that says, what is it? The color get color. If you put down the right value, color gets all the credit. You know, because people
right.
will look at something and go, "Oh my God, I love that color," but in reality, you know. If you were to just take that color and look at it on its own, as opposed to everything else that's around it, you'd say, "Man, that's kind of a nasty looking gray purple. That's not what I would call like, you know, I couldn't wait to make a shirt out of that color." You know, I mean, it's you know, it's only beautiful because it's let's say true, and it's only beautiful because the surrounding values and colors are also true. You know, so to answer your question about values, a lot of times, you know, when I'm working, I'm getting tongue-tied because obviously I get excited. I get excited. I have so much to say. None of it will come out of my mouth. When you're looking at something, when you're creating a painting, the most important, besides composition, okay, which obviously is maybe the
right.
most important decision you make, the next one would certainly be values. And you have to ascertain, you know, by looking at everything that you're going to paint, everything that's going to be in your field of vision, you know, what's the lightest value, what's the darkest value, what are the values in between. And a lot of the values that are in between, let's say in the medium range, they're going to be defined by color temperature, because a lot of times you're going to, you know, you'll look at values and say, okay, well, that value and that value are very, very close, but there's a big difference in color temperature. Am I answering this question properly?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And sometimes there's a mistake that can easily be made. I mean, it happens to the best of us, which is if you look at something very, very, very warm, let's say, like sunlight hitting grass, for instance.
Right.
Because it's so warm, the instinct sometimes is to make it higher in value than it really is, because you're saying, wow, look at how bright that is. But in reality, it's just warm. So, mm-hmm. you know, you'll start using too much yellow or something, and then you look at it and you go, boy, that looks god-awful. Why? You know, it's because the value is off, you know. So a lot of times when you're working, you know, you have to be very, very cognizant of, yes, this is warm, yes, this is cool. Oh, that can also happen sometimes with shadows. If you're painting, you'll say, wow, that's really, really cool in temperature, and the instinct might be to make the value darker than it really is, you know. So unless you want to do something for dramatic purposes, which I also do, you know, you know, then you can darken or lighten something, but you should do it only because you want to do it, not because it's getting away from you in some way. So I hope I'm answering that question. I mean, you know, like you look at a bright sky and you look at a tree line against the sky. You know, yes, the sky could be bright, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the value is light. You know, a lot of times, You know this, Linda, you paint. I mean, a lot of times you can look at a cloud and it almost comes off like it's white, but then you look into the valley below and you see sunlight slamming into a house and you go, no, wait a minute, now that's white, okay? And then you look back at the cloud and you go, no, that's actually sort of a, that's more in the gray family. That's about two values, you know? And then, right. You know, then, you know, you can turn away from that quote white house. And, you know, if you've got a white car that's parked 30 feet away, you look at that and you go, no, wait a minute, now that's white. You know, now that I look at the house, that house is actually about a number two value and that cloud is about a number five. And so you really have to look and compare to everything around you in order to, that's how you get truth. You know, that's how, and it's all observation. You know, I came up with an interesting thought about 6-8 months ago, which was, I realized that I was getting better. Okay. And I was like, well, why am I getting better? You know, because I'm, and I was like, I was looking at my paints and I said to myself, well, I'm still using paint. I'm still using a brush, you know, I'm using the same paint and, you know, since I started out, I'm using basically paints and brushes. So, and technically I'm getting better, but how am I really getting better? And all it really came down to, which is a huge thing, is my ability to observe had gotten sharper. My abilities to see things have gotten clearer. Because a lot of times, you know, students will ask you basically the wrong question, which is they'll say, what color is that? Or they'll say, what brush did you use for that? That's really the wrong question, because the technique should always follow the intent. You know, once you know exactly what you want to say based on what you are seeing, how you say it becomes very clear to you. Do you know what I'm saying? Because a lot of times people will ask you technical questions and it's coming at it the wrong way. You know, if you're becoming overly involved with technique, then you're not really observing. You're trying to come up with a trick, you know?
Right.
So anyway, I hope I answered that.
Yeah, but you did. And one of the things that I always challenge my students to do, and because I do it and I find it really rewarding, is to remove color initially if we have the time in the studio, which I'm teaching in a studio, so we absolutely have the time. So mm-hmm. I start them with doing value studies and I ask them to limit themselves to five values.
That's the smartest thing you could do.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, and they get so, they're so happy with their work in the black and white, you know, on the value range, that they don't even want to put color on it. It's like looking at an Ansel Adams, you know?
Yeah.
Why is this stuff so strong? Because he has value and he has composition down. And, and so we go through that whole conversation, and they don't believe me until they do it. And then once they start out that way, they stay that way. Because it's like, well, I'm going to figure out what all my values are here, from my darkest dark to my lightest light, and go from there. And then when they start putting color on, they know they have to mix to that particular value. And, you know, it shows you the strength so early on in your painting. And then from that point on, it becomes color choices within the proper value that's already on the canvas.
Yep.
So I think value doesn't get, in some people's minds, doesn't get the same, you know, credit that it should get, or doesn't seem to have a lot of people paying attention to it.
It's essential. It's absolutely essential, because like to come full circle, like a lot of times, like Linda, you go to museums and, or, you know, you look at it, paintings and books, and, you know, we all marvel at some, you know, like deep red or, you know, some beautiful, cool blue. But in reality, that color in of itself, it's a nice color, but it's because of color relationships that true value of that color jumps out at us, and what we're really responding to is the truth. You know, and then we might say, well, what a beautiful blue, or what a beautiful orange, or what a wonderful cool green. But in reality, you know, again, that color is only getting to us emotionally because it's true in that universe.
Right, right. And then the other thing that I always find very tricky, and my students find very tricky, I always love saying this to them, is, you know, reflected light in the shadow area, and temperature-wise, it's very, very warm. And, you know, it's so also don't say, no, this is the same value as what the shadow is, but it's just warm in temperature. And I always say this, okay.
I'm not
going to paint it that way.
Yeah, I have to tell you, I have noticed lately, and I don't know if it's just through my observations of looking at things, I'm starting to notice that a lot of times I think that even with warm light, as a general rule, that shadows that are supposed to be cool, you could run into problems, obviously. You could create a muddy painting if you don't watch out, but I've noticed that with a lot of warm light, even in cool shadows, there is also still quite a bit of warmth, because I noticed, because as I've been observing stuff, this is like in the last 6-8 months of painting outdoors and observing stuff, there's a lot of light that bounces off of light areas into cool shadows, you know, and it has a tendency to warm them up a little. So I've been noticing that a lot, you know, like, so I've been trying to put some of that into my paintings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, cast shadows, you should be able to see through them, and, you know, things like that. Those are all very, very tricky, but they all still come back to, you know, the value of
well, Linda, you're 100% right. That's exactly right. Cause when you talk about a cast shadow, you see that's a classic example, like, especially like on a bright day, you know, see, and that, here's another thing that people tend to forget. Like, you might see a cast shadow and get excited about it and make it darker than it really is. And then, you know, it looks like a snake or something, you know, on your canvas as opposed to a real shadow. In reality, that cast shadow is also going to have a lot of warmth in it with a warm light, because it's going across an object that's probably very, you know, that's warm, you know? So that shadow is going to probably be lighter in value than you think. And the other thing is that I think people have a tendency to forget about, and John Carlson's always talking about it in his book, is that nature is constantly in motion. You know, we look at paint, we look at things as painters, and we have a tendency to try to freeze them in our mind, you know, like we're shooting a high-speed photograph or something in our brain. But in reality, everything is in motion. Even still water is moving. I mean, there's a little wind, there's a little ripple, you know, the leaves are constantly moving a little bit in the breeze, you know, so you got to try to get that motion in there. Those cast shadows are going to be moving to some degree. So to just paint them with these rock solid sharp edges and dark values, they're never going to look right, you know, so you have to take all of those other things into consideration as you're painting.
I'm looking, we're looking at it. I know you're on the phone so you can't see it, but we're looking at one of your snow paintings, with beautiful cast shadows of blues and purples, and there's some oranges in there, or reds. Well, the oranges from the building, that has the path. And I don't know the name of it. Sarah,
I don't know the name of it. I'm sorry.
I must have got lucky that day.
It's one you sent me, I think, probably from your new book. I'm not sure, but it's the stream and snow, and I just love it.
Yeah, it's got an orange wood building, and then the beautiful cast shadows on the path, and then you have the stream that's off to the left.
It's
really done really nicely. And you can see, I mean, you even have some snow in there that, you know, as a gray, if you isolate it by itself, it would be a very gray color on the probably blue-purple side, but it looks like, you know, reflected light hitting snow and shadow. And then you've got some really pretty warm blues in that shadow as well. So that particular what we were just talking about cast shadows really comes out in this particular painting.
Linda, you know, again, guys, it's all observation. You know what I mean? It's like, if I were teaching a landscape class and I would love to do that at some point, but I never have enough time to do anything. But at some point, maybe when I get a little older, I'll put together like a landscape painting class. But I would literally take students, you know, into the forest and have everybody sit down on chairs and nobody paint. Just look at the forest, watch the sun go down. You know, we don't always, you know, the funny thing, like for instance, like the plein air convention that's coming up, you know, I noticed that because I've taught at some of these things. And what's really remarkable to me is, you know, you have all these students all over the world, right? And they paint and they, you know, they're really working hard at it. But like all of us, they're making the same mistakes over and over and over and over again. And then they go to the plein air, right? I mean, we all do this. Like, I'll make the same dopey mistake for 20 years until I catch myself and go, oh, boy. But boy, I was just not observing this properly, you know. And then all the students get together, and there's thousands of them, and they all take to the hillsides, and then they all open up their easels, and then they make the same mistakes again at the plein air convention, you know. So it's like, what I want to, when I teach, what I want to try to drill into people's heads is that it's not that they can't paint, because it's that they're not observing correctly. Like, I had a student once in Carmel, and the student asked me, how do I paint this? And I said, well, I think you're asking me the wrong question. I said, what do you see? And she said, well, I really like this water and the way it's rippling. I said, okay. She goes, and I like that grass over there because it's soft. I said, okay, now we're getting somewhere. She goes, and I like those rocks because I really, really like those sharp edges. I said, don't you realize you've already painted this painting? You said soft, you said sharp, you know, you said light, you said warmth. Now, if you were going to put down a hard edge, what would you use? She goes, my painting knife. I said, yeah, that would be a great choice. I said, for soft, you wouldn't use the knife, would you? She said, no. I said, okay. I said, don't you understand? You're already starting to think like an artist. It's just you're looking, you're observing, and you're breaking it down in your head, and you're asking yourself, how, you know, what tools am I going to use to try to express my emotions about what I'm seeing and what I am feeling about what I'm seeing. And that's really all you're doing, you know.
Well, I'm going to break a rule that I have, but only because we've been talking about cast shadows. And Jimmy wrote in a question for us that he says, what do you mean by seeing through the cast shadow?
Did I say that?
Seeing
through a cast shadow?
Yeah.
I'm not sure what that means exactly, Jimmy. Okay.
Okay.
But
you want
seeing,
me to take it?
Yeah, go ahead, you take it.
Okay. What you have a core shadow which absolutely sees no light. Think of it as if a child is sitting on the ground and sunlight is coming in and hitting him, a core shadow will receive no light, so it would be your darkest dark value. A cast shadow is not your darkest dark value, it's actually up a few values. And because of that, in other words, if I'm looking through at a tree that's casting a shadow onto the green grass, that shadow is not blue. It's a color of blue-green, maybe, that also I should be able to see the grass underneath it. So I don't make my shadow, my cast shadow, as dark as my core shadow, because my cast shadow is receiving light. That's how I would explain it.
That's pretty darn good.
Okay, so Jimmy, I hope that answers your question. If not, let us know and we'll try to tackle it again.
Linda said it.
Okay, yay, I got something right.
So if it doesn't work out, Jimmy, blame Linda, okay?
Yeah, don't blame George, blame me.
No, I'm kidding. That's a great explanation. And if I'll take maybe one slight step further, which is, again, you always ask yourself, why are things behaving the way they're behaving?
Yes.
In any cast shadow, the cool the coolness of the sky, okay, that, which is the, you have warm light coming through a cool blue sky, let's say, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming shadow is on a warm day.
Mm-hmm.
Some of that blue from that sky is going to end up in that cast shadow, some version of it, you know, because, and probably some of that warmth that's coming through the light is also going to bounce around and reflect into that cast shadow. So a lot of times when I'm working, you always go back to the light source, you know, which is mm-hmm. what color is the light and what color is the sky that light is coming through. And once you know these, you know, once you can answer those questions, then it's just kind of logical, you know. You go, okay, the grass is green, you know, whatever green that grass is, and it's being affected by orange light. So if that's the case, that green, the local color of the grass being green, okay, is going to warm up with a bit of orange, and that blue from that sky is also going to end up in those shadows. So some version of that blue is going to end up in those shadows, you know, but which then can get me to color harmony. But
we'll get there.
You'll get there. Okay.
Yeah. Another thing to add on to what you were saying is
okay.
If you think about water, whether that's in a creek or whether that's in a glass. I always ask my student, what color is water? And they always come back and say blue.
Right.
And I'm like, really? And I'm like, let's go look at this.
You know, yeah.
Water really doesn't have a color. It takes on the color that's around it.
That's right.
So you know, so we go through this whole, and then, you know, when that observation becomes reality and the mind hole opens up and how you see things. So again, like you were saying, you know, you have a blue sky and it's going through a tree that has green leaves. The creek underneath, which what we're looking at right now, is going to take on all of the colors that are around it. The oranges
it's
from gonna, the rock, green, yeah.
It's going to take on every single color around it, and it's also going to take the color of the mud that's underneath it.
Right.
See, a lot of times, like if you look at a dark part of a stream, and you know there's reflections in it, and then there's also these sort of darker areas where the water gets more still, let's say, that actually, those dark areas can get quite warm, I've noticed. And the reason mm-hmm. for that is you're really looking through the clear water is what you're doing down to the mud at the bottom, you know, to
right.
the mud on the sides. And mud is essentially, I mean, when it's being hit with some kind of light, it is a warm dark generally, you know, unless it's
right.
in complete shadow. But anyway, I could go on forever.
Yeah, yeah, well, good, because we got
yeah.
like 30 minutes to go. If you have
okay.
any questions,
yeah.
remember to type it in. And Sarah, I'm actually with Sarah in the studio today.
Hi.
And so I get to spend some time with Sarah today. But type them in, and we'll actually get to them in about 30 minutes. So
keep it, and that's your question.
Send them the questions, yes. So one more question about value, George, and then we're going to head into color relationships and harmonies.
Okay.
You know, when I did a lot of studying a master's like everybody does, and
mm-hmm.
I do this a lot. I download one of the old master's paintings that I absolutely love or that I stumble across, and I turn it into black and white because I just want to see what they're doing with value. And, you know, we've always said Sargent paints with no more than five. I've seen Fetchin paint using no more than two values, most of the time three to four. But I've seen one of his paintings that had wonderful color, but just used two values in it.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, Monet uses anywhere from three to four. So
mm-hmm.
do you go out and try to reduce the number of value shifts you have in your painting, or do you just, you don't care? You know, you
I
have
don't...
10 and you're going to use as many as you want.
I don't I'm not cognizant of you know the you know I got the butler show coming up, the truck is here to drop off a couple of framed paintings, so Josh went downstairs to talk to the guy.
Oh, okay.
So if you hear banging
yeah, we'll
around
talk about
Yeah, if you hear banging around, that's my painting. My frame painting's hitting the walls as they're coming into this.
Don't bang it around, you'll dent it.
No, I know. Boom. Oh, that was a good one. That was my favorite. Anyway.
Yeah, how much is that one going to cost now?
Yes, right,
I might
right.
be able to afford it.
We're going to have a fire sale. It's a discount. What was the question? I'm sorry. I went completely south.
Yeah, this is really a sidestep because you didn't want to answer the question. I know
right.
you are.
Yeah, sure. That was my ploy. Yeah, the truck's in the driveway. Yeah. No, no, it really is. You were
How many
asked,
values
oh,
do you
oh,
put
that's
in your
right.
painting?
No, I don't cognizantly count them. You know, and I'm not certain how many I really use. You know, I mean, if I had to guess, I'd say seven-ish. You know, I try to simplify it. I do when I'm painting a landscape painting, I do a lot of squinting. Mm-hmm. You know, in order to try to find patterns and connect things also, because I think you can break a painting up too much if you don't watch out. So I try to find, you know, one massive sort of dark area, you know, one light area. And then like compositionally, I try to connect them somehow, even if they don't connect in reality, because, you know, right. you don't want spots all over the canvas, you know?
Yeah.
And yes, there are value shifts inside of big masses, but you know, if it's an extreme shift, you know, I'll include it. But as a general rule, I try to find ways to meld them, you know, in order to create something a little more cohesive, let's say. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm not cognizant of how many I'm using all the time. But I am very aware of it. I mean, when you come upon a location or something that you want to paint, or I look at something and my first instinct is like, oh wow, that's pretty, you know. And then the next thing is, okay, if I'm going to paint that, how am I going to paint that, and you know, what is the composition? And the next question is, what are the values? But I don't like to answer your question. Sorry, I don't cognizantly. I'm not cognizant of counting how many values I'm using. I just pretty much eyeball it, you know?
Right. Yeah, I surprised myself recently too, because I really thought that I was not paying attention to value and ended up still having it within my goal of 3 to 4, no more than 5. And it really surprised me when I turned one of my paintings into the black and white on my computer and went, wow, okay, well, maybe this is becoming second nature more than I think it is.
Oh, that's great. Linda, I'll tell you, your values are very sharp, because I look at what you do, you know, I had somebody recently, huh?
You're a sweetheart.
No, it's the truth, you know. Because you gave us that lovely painting of the house by the... and it's just beautiful. I mean, it's... And the only way you could get that warm and cool thing that you've got, because that's a pretty subtle painting, even though it's got a lot of color in it, but it's also, you know, it doesn't have that mistake that we all can make, which is, you know, you just start pushing the hell out of all the colors. I mean, look, and nobody's been more guilty of this than me, okay, where you just get so damn excited, you just start pushing everything, and then before you look at it and you go, that is just a garish, ugly mess I've just created, you know. So
where's that palette knife?
Yeah, where's my lighter fluid and matches? But you know, the only way you can do that is to keep the values in the right range, which you did beautifully in that painting, you know.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, you got it. But did we answer that question?
Yeah, I think
what,
so.
Oh, yeah, okay.
How about we move on to creating atmosphere?
Okay.
Because I think that gets into a lot of the, you know, color harmony relationship conversation. You know, it probably adds in perspective as well, but we won't go there.
Atmospheric perspective?
Yeah. Well, we
yeah, I mean, it's all part of it. I mean, they're all part of the same thing. Yeah, I mean, Go ahead. I'm sorry. No, I just started thinking about it for a second. Something that's 10 feet away is obviously it's richer in color than something that's 1,000 feet away. Yeah. Painting atmosphere?
Right. Yes. That's the question.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because like David LaFell talks about this a lot. You know, David LaFell and I are best buddies, and we literally talk on the phone, I would say, about painting 3 times a week, 4 times a week. And, you know, we just call each other all the time. And, you know, he does mainly portraits and still lifes, you know, so his, you know, he'll paint something that's things that are inches apart, you know, and he gets the feeling of something being much closer that's, you know, 3 feet away from him, and then something that's 4 feet away from him. And he'll definitely get those, that atmosphere. He really is very much about painting the air around an object, you know. I mean, when you're outside painting, I mean, you're painting things that are 30 feet away, and you can also paint something that's 5 miles away in the same painting. You know, you have a distant mountain, and you can have grass, a field that's basically 30 feet in front of you. Part of painting a landscape, you know, I mean, the hard part, I mean, it never gets easier. I think it doesn't get easier because I think as we get better, we start to push ourselves to do new things. It's always a challenge. I mean, part of the challenge of, we're talking about painting atmosphere, correct?
Right.
Part of the challenge is there's two things that go on, or there's several things that go on, but there's two things that go on when you're painting. One is what's really going on in front of you, okay? And that's what goes on in nature. And then there's like, what am I saying about what's going on in front of me? Because if you just sort of mindlessly paint what's going on in front of you, you can paint something that's accurate but isn't a terrific painting. So if I'm, let's say, I'm going to just try to get the audience to picture this with me. If I'm standing, let's say, on a hillside and I'm overlooking grass that goes down to the edge of a stream, and there's a bunch of trees on the left, and there's a stream, right, through the trees, and then there's a distant hill on the other side of the stream, and there's light slamming into a couple of homes, all right? And then beyond that, there's a, let's say, a mountain sort of melting, you know, into some lovely hazy sky, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, I look at that, and I go, okay, that's a beautiful composition, and I am going to feature a few of the things that I'm seeing, but the story that I'm going to tell is the light slamming into those distant homes, okay? And mm-hmm. because I want to give a feeling of sort of, yes, this beautiful landscape, but there's some hope across the river, okay? Let's say that's kind of a, you know, there's something beautiful and happy, and there's some hope across the river. That's going to inform also how I paint it. So I'm going to, you know, I will use sharper edges, let's say, in those homes than I might use in the grass, which is only 30 feet away. But yeah. I'm not making a painting about the grass. I'm making a painting about those homes in the distance. So I'm going to suggest that grass, and I'm going to, even though it's closer, and even if it might be up a notch in value, I might subdue it, because I don't want your eye to start going all over the place and go, what the hell is this painting about, you know? Because I'm going to try to feature one thing in the painting. So everything in that painting is going to be, let's say, subservient, you know, to the main theme, you know, which is the light across the river. So I may play around with some values and some color in order to help tell that story, because again, if I paint exactly what's in front of me, I'm I'm only copying what I'm seeing, and I'm not saying very much. You know, I'm more of a reporter than I am an artist, you know. So right. Somebody's calling in. Isn't that funny? Who's calling in? That's the frame shop. So the paint atmosphere, you know, atmosphere, it's also like, you see, these things are all interrelated. It's very funny, like atmosphere, you talk about how do you paint atmosphere? Atmosphere is, you have to imagine as you're painting outdoors that there's almost like, you know, like in theater, I guess you call them scrims, right? It's almost like these curtains that are like translucent curtains that are hanging every 100 feet or so, you know? And in those curtains, you know, in the atmosphere, there's particles, there's moisture, and there's all of this stuff out there that's sort of unseen, but it's very, very much there, and it's picking up light, you know, because there's little particles, it's picking up light, and it's also picking up the coolness of the sky. And as things recede, they have a tendency to get cooler, and they also have a tendency to get lighter in value. So, I mean, it's not, as a general rule, I would say that's like, it's generally right. True. I know one could argue that that's not always the case. And yes, that's not always the case. You could be standing in a dark shadow and look at something in the distance that's in the light. And yes, that the stuff in the distance will be much warmer. Yeah, of course. You know, right. That's, but as a general rule, I mean, if the light were to hit the things in front of you suddenly and the things in the back, you would realize how much brighter the stuff was in the foreground, and the stuff in the back would fall more into the gray family, you know. I hope I'm answering this properly.
Yep, and, you got and, there.
Yeah, an atmosphere is a combination of values, okay, and edges, okay?
There you go.
And,
that's what
and,
I wanted you to say.
Okay, good. Because, and how does one describe an edge? Well, an edge is where two objects meet in space. So let's say that tree line against the sky, if the sky has a lot of bright clouds in it, as a general rule, that edge would be harder because you have dark objects meeting light objects, you know, in space. But mm-hmm. also, you know, you have to be, again, you have to squint and you have to have a lot of observations, because if there's a lot of light slamming, let's say, into the sky, you know, into those clouds, it can also cause refraction. And that means those hard edges might start get eaten away on the side, you know, because the light is so intense, you know, it wouldn't create such a hard edge. You know what I mean? It would cause some of those edges to melt. So, and the best way to describe, to paint atmosphere as things recede into distance, is that the values all become closer and closer and closer to one another, and the edges would become softer and softer because the values are similar. I mean, one of the best ways to describe an edge is you don't have to blend an edge. If the two values are so close, you just lay them next to each other, they're going to blend automatically. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Really, did I answer that, or did I put everybody uh-huh. to sleep for sure?
Well, no, let me wake Sarah up.
All right, Sarah.
I'm kidding.
Okay.
yeah. So let's take it a little bit further and talk about color theory a little bit. So let's start with something that you're comfortable with, which is your Michael Harding oil colors that you paint with.
Yes.
So hello, Karen and Michael.
Hello, Karen and Michael. Look, I've never painted with paint like this in my life. It's like painting with light. I mean, you know, they some of the colors are a little pricier than let's say the stuff you buy, you know, in the art store. But I got to tell you, they're so concentrated. that like the cadmium lemon yellow, like when you put it out, I literally am on location and I put their cadmium lemon yellow out on the palette and it's almost like, man, that's bright. You know, it's like you don't need to put out like half a tube, you know what I mean, to try to get a good color because it's so highly concentrated, you know. So a little of that stuff goes a long way, man. It's really, it's amazing paint.
So tell us your basic palette, what you put out every time you go out to paint.
Okay. This is sort of my major bugaboo, okay? I use, and then I'll explain color theory, okay, which I am just, Linda, right. I am astonished at how many painters today, and I mean good ones, you know, they're winging color theory and they don't really understand color theory. And when I explain to people color theory and about how the eye works with the cones and the rods and the science behind all of it, they look at me like, what are you talking about? Or that sounds like a formula. And I'm saying, no, 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 no. It's the science of color. Okay. I'll explain all of this. All right. I used basically two reds, two blues, and two yellows. I use orange in the middle. I'll explain the palette, okay? At the bottom of the palette, I have ultramarine blue. That is a blue with some red in it, okay? And, all right, I get so excited. The next color is alizarin, which is a red with some blue in it. So those create the purest purple. The next color up is cadmium red deep. That is a red, but it's a little bit in the yellow family, okay, because it's red, okay? The next one up is cadmium orange. That's the center of the palette. The next one up is cadmium yellow deep, which is a yellow, but it's in the orange family, okay? The next one up is cadmium lemon yellow, which is the brightest of all yellows, but it's also the coolest because it's got just a touch of blue. And then the last color is phthalo blue, which is a blue with some yellow in it, all right? So, and then I have black and white. I have ivory black all the way at the bottom, and then I have titanium white at the top.
Okay.
Here's what I am always shocked. Okay, now this palette was devised by, well, really it comes out of something from the turn of the last century, George Wesley Bellows, was playing around with something called the Murata color system. I mean, I was just obsessed with color, you know. So when people ask me, how do you get all these colors and how do you understand color? Like, I mean, the truth of it is I really worked at it, and I've probably done more reading than just about anybody I know about color. And a lot of these color theories started, you know, grew out of, well, originally Monet and Pissarro, and all of these discussions they were having about how to get colors to vibrate. Like when you put greens next to reds, they have a tendency to vibrate. Now, because greens and reds are opposite on the color scale, there's a very well-known painting book out right now. I'm not going to mention names, okay? That has a chapter on color that I find to be quite erroneous. There's a mention in the book that says that the color wheel has nothing to do with painting. Okay. That is just not true. Okay. Because, I mean, it's just scientifically, it's not true. Because first of all, when you have cones in your eyes, okay, the book that you need to read, okay, if you want to read about color and truly understanding color, is Emil Gruppe's book called Gruppe on Color. That's G-R-U-P-P-E. Emil Gruppe wrote the definitive book on how to paint landscape paintings outdoors, and he basically took the, because Emil Gruppe knew George Wesley Bellows, who I think Bellows is one of the greatest painters this country ever produced, and Bellows was a color nut, and Gruppe took a lot of these theories from Bellows and I'd say refined them and wrote this book, and it really explains it beautifully. But what people don't seem to understand, and even I think a lot of artists, they may know it instinctively, but they don't understand the science behind it, okay? Because you got to read these books that were written 50, 60, 70 years ago. Okay, there's two ways of thinking about this, and one of them is, I'm sorry, not to sound like a, I don't want to say a bad word, not to sound arrogant, okay? One way is correct, and one way is simply wrong, okay? And to understand the science of color harmony, if you put ultramarine blue with a little bit of white, okay, next to green, which happens a lot when you're painting outdoors, you'll notice when you're painting in the summertime, it's very, very hard sometimes to create beautiful paintings of green, because it's green, green, and more green, and then you have a blue sky and blue water with green. I mean, I know a lot of students will say, yeah, he's right. You know, why do you start running into so much trouble with all of that green? Okay, it's because the complement of red is missing in the painting. Okay, when you paint in the fall, you'll come across the compliments naturally just by looking at things, you know, because it's sort of hard to miss them because you've got green grass and you've got, you know, the leaves are turning orange and you, there's purple. I mean, the colors are very, very obvious in autumn scenes. You know, they're a little easier to paint, as long as you don't get them to be garish. But they naturally fall into color harmony. When you start painting outdoors, let's say in the summer, what a lot of people don't understand is that the complement of red is missing, and therefore you create kind of a chalky, nasty-looking painting, okay? Mm-hmm. But if you look, really look, at a white cloud on a very green day, there will always be the complement of red in that cloud. If you really look, you'll say it looks like a warm gray, but it is definitely in the red family, okay? If you ever look at rocks on a very green day, if you ever look at, let's say, stones that appear to be white, if you look at them, they tend to be in the red family, meaning like there's almost like a pinkish tone to those rocks. Edward Redfield, okay, he was writing to Daniel Garber to talk about color harmony, okay? Redfield and Garber were the two, probably the best Pennsylvania Impressionist painters, and they were friends, and they were writing letters back and forth. And Redfield wrote this amazing letter to Garber, and in it he says, went out and painted a beautiful spring scene today, okay? I'm paraphrasing, okay? Beautiful buds, beautiful warm spring day, painted a flock of sheep in the green light, with all the green, the sheep looked purple, standing in the shadows, okay? Which, you know, you can imagine that, you know? The sheep aren't purple, but in a green color universe, that gray could go purple, okay? Then he wrote, painted a wonderful autumn scene today, same spot that I did the spring scene, earlier in the season, with all the reds, the sheep appeared green. Now, you can imagine that, but the eye constantly craves the compliment. It's why when you look at those Christmas cards, you know, with like extreme reds and greens in them, you'll notice they sometimes almost vibrate like neon. And that's because the two opposite colors on the color wheel on the spectrum, they cause each other to vibrate. This is what the Impressionists picked up on, you know, 150 years ago, is that if you put an orange yellow next to a violet, they will start to vibrate because they're opposites on the color wheel. So to say that the color wheel has nothing to do with painting is almost idiocy to me, okay? I mean, if you're looking at green trees, you know, on a bright day with lots of color, lots of orangey light, okay, what's the complement of green? The complement of green is red. And a lot of red will be in those shadows. The best way to knock down a green, a lot of times people, this is where they get into trouble when you start painting, you know, splits, let's say summer scenes. A lot of times, you know, you'll say, I want to cool out that green because it's falling into shadow, and you'll add blue, which right. Blue and green start to fight each other, you know, and it'll never look right. But in reality, the complement of red is being introduced into that green. So
right.
If you look back at the palette, every one of those colors, there's not, it's what you would call a pure color palette because there's no browns. But you'll also notice that every one of those colors has a secondary color in it. It's not like, I'm always shocked that when I talk to painters, you know, they'll be, you know, and I'm not saying it's a bad color to use, but they'll be using cobalt blue. Well, cobalt blue is a pure blue, okay? There's no other color in it. It's just blue. But ultramarine blue is a bit in the purple family, okay? Because that blue has the complement of red in it, it will automatically look better next to a green. So if you paint the sky with cobalt blue and you put green next to it, it's going to look, it's just not going to vibrate. But if you were to paint it with ultramarine blue because of that touch of red, and you put that next to the green, you already have instant color harmony. And anybody who tells you that there's no such thing as instant color harmony doesn't understand the science of color. And it's you can hear me getting passionate about this, but it's just shocking to me. It's like, how can you not know this? It's how your eye reads color. It's how you're, look, the abstract painters know this. I mean, they don't deal with objects and symbols. They just use colors, you know? And a lot of abstract guys, they'll know this, you know, because that's all they do is deal in color. But you know, a lot of landscape painters will go, well, I don't know, and da-da-da-da. And I'm like, dude, you know, it's like, crack a book, you know? Read about the science of color. Read about how your eye sees color, how it get. Michael Harding and I have had discussions about this, and Michael Harding said, you're one of the few painters that actually knows this stuff. I'm like, yeah, well, you know, I go to the library, I read, you know. It's like, you know, when I became interested in color, I wanted to know, how does color work? How does it work through the brain? How does it, you know, when it goes through the eye, and how does the eye discern, you know, color and then, you know, whatever, I could go on and on, you know, but
yeah.
I'm telling you, if you follow what I just said, it opens up a world of thinking. And I'm not the first guy to say this, okay? I mean, the father of this thinking is Monet, and he knew a thing or two about color, okay? So, like, if you want to argue with him, fine. You want to argue with George Wesley Bellows, fine. You want to argue with John F. Carlson, Emil Gruppi, you know, now you're arguing with the gods of impressionist painting. You know, I some of this thought has gotten lost in the last 50, 60 years. That's why I went back and started reading books that were written 1910, 1920, you know, when these guys were really all at their peak. And some of this has just gotten lost. And I think there's so much misinformation out there now on color. I'm sort of astonished. And by the way, David LaFell, you know, concurs with what I've said, because I'll call him up and I'll say, did you read this nonsense? And he'll be like, George, I can't believe it. It's just wrong. And I go, I know, I can't. I mean, this is all we do. We, you know, we call each other. Did you read this? Yes, it's wrong. You know, I mean,
yeah,
so.
Yeah, I was there when one of your conversations happened. I was at your house. So it was kind
yeah,
of like,
that's right.
Listening to you two.
Yeah, that's right. And it's like, how do you not know that red next to green is a complement? And if you want to, I mean, it's like painting 101. It's not even, whatever.
You know, and that's why I like, my students always fight me on this, because I like to start them with a limited palette, which is, I consider unlimited, but it helps them to start to understand color theory, you know, especially when they're painting something. I go, I'll throw a little red in there, and they'll look at me like, why?
Yeah.
And then Linda, we go through that whole conversation that you just went through. But
Linda, the limited palette is really the only way to go, okay? Because, first of all, to say I need 50, 60 colors or I need 20 colors, you don't need 20 colors. If you know what you're doing, it's either red, it's, look, let's get down to brass tacks. It's either red, it's either blue, it's either green, it's either orange, it's either yellow, it's either white or black. I mean, there's no other thing it could be. Because there's only those colors out there, okay? And then there's only one other thing to consider. It's either a warm version or a cool version of those colors. That's all it can be. To say that you need chartreuse number 6 and electric yellow 9, this is nonsense, okay? Because to finish the thought, okay?
Go ahead.
You and me could go out and play Tiger Woods, okay? And he has a broom, and we have the greatest clubs in the world. He's going to kick our butt out there, okay? Because he knows what to do with that broom, okay? He'll line up, boom, he hits the ball. He's got a plan. He knows exactly what he's doing. It doesn't matter. We have every tool in the bag. We're not going to beat him, okay? Because he's a professional golfer. If you know what you're doing as a painter, you don't need a million colors on the palette.
Yeah, the next set over on my Artistic Harmony website, one of the things that I'm going to end up putting up is another kind of a free course challenge. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be providing them with color palettes, different color palettes, not necessarily like ultramarine blue or alizarin crimson, but mixing it up with different color choices that are in the red family and the blue family and things like that to see what they end up with.
That's very smart.
To try to paint with, just to kind of expand our palettes a little and really start thinking about color a little bit more. So I'm going to be doing that probably over the next couple of weeks, putting that together as a free course off of my Artistic Harmonies website. But
that's great.
Anyway,
that's really smart.
We are actually getting into go ahead, George. You want to?
No, I mean, again, look, just to wrap up color harmony.
Yeah.
Color harmony is the easiest to spot in the early morning and in the evening, okay, because that's when it's most obvious. And, you'll look at it. The sky will turn orange. And if the sky is orange, like if I'm a betting man, I'll lay your dollars to donuts that the shadows are going to go into the purple family. They have to, because the sky is orange. I mean, everything starts breaking down into complements, those rich greens, the shadows also, you know what I'm saying? If the light is orange, the shadows will invariably, have some form of violet in them, So anyway, I'm done. Sorry.
Okay.
All right.
Sarah, if you can pull up.
That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Right.
Thank you. Yeah. I like how you stick to it, though. That's a good thing.
Right.
We've got a lot of questions about what paints that you and I use, and they are Michael Harding handmade oil colors with a U, because our friend is British.
Yes.
I wanted to mention that Michael and Karen have just been working with me. I have a set of what I call a limited palette. It's a set of 6 paints. It is now available. The post to my website just went out at 1:00. So you can go out and order this set for about 45% off. And then we also have an offering for George, which includes George's book, Impressionist Painting with George Gallo. It's a deluxe collection. It has some of the paints that George uses, Michael Harding paints, and you can get George's book, the paint, the local color DVD, and a New Wave Artist Finished Highland Palette, and some Raymar Belgian linen panels. So, and they have that discounted, especially for this conversation that we're having, this chat we're having with George. So I wanted to mention those two things, and Sarah will be answering some questions. These links will go out in the email, so if you registered for it, the links will be in there.
Yeah, you can find this at northlightshop.com. If you just search for Gallo, you'll find it. And you can get all of these things in this nice little kit that's normally $231, so $110.33 is a pretty good discount.
Yeah.
Get everything you need. Do you mind if I tell them about the other discount really quickly?
Yeah.
We also have, if you don't want to get the whole kit, say you already have some of that stuff and you just want to pick up George's book, Impressionist Painting for the Landscape, we're going to do 15% off the book and ebook version. In that, you can use code GALLO15 upon checkout, and that's good for about a month. So be sure to take advantage of that, and that will be coming your way in the follow-up email as well.
Okay. And now we're going to go to questions. And by the way, my my painting book out on Kindle, How to Paint from Brush to Palette Night, is 99 cents for the next day.
Oh. Well,
so if you want to get my book, it's out on Amazon Kindle,
How to Paint from Brush to
Palette Night.
Okay.
I can't autograph that electronically for you, George.
All right. Well, then I'll when I see you.
There you go.
I'll see you next
month. So anyway, that's out there for 99 cents as well. I just happened to do a Kindle countdown with that at the same time, and it just happened, thought I'd mention it. So now that that's all done, when shameless plugs are done.
Shameless plugs by Linda Fisler, yes.
Yeah, so we're going to let Sarah ask you some questions.
Yeah, we've got quite a few great questions already submitted here, and I just want to invite everyone listening to type their questions into the questions section of the GoToWebinar control panel, and we'll get to as many of these as we can here in the next 20 minutes or so. The first one is from Melanie, and she asks, could you ask the host to give their perspective on creating color charts?
The host? You want my perspective on creating color charts?
She says host, plural, so I think she
both of you. Okay. I've done something similar to color charts, and what I've done, and I think it's actually very helpful, is just to stand outside with my easel and a blank canvas or board, and I just start mixing colors that I see out there, and then I just push those colors as far as I can on there and make a chart that way. So if you're talking about, you know, the regular old school color charts of, you know, you put a green up here and then you add colors to it all the way down. I don't particularly do that, but to train my eye, I will stand outside on plein air and mix colors for the sole purpose of mixing colors that I see outside. And I keep those charts in my studio. So if I'm looking for a particular color that I want to use in a painting, I've got those, what I call true colors from seeing outside in my studio. And I actually have a YouTube video out there about that, like, how to capture green, and I talk about how I did this process. So there is a YouTube video out there. It may only be accessible through my Artistic Harmonies website, but it is out there somewhere on my YouTube channel. So George, what about your perspective on creating color charts?
To be completely forthright, I think it's kind of a waste of time. Yeah, that's the kindest way I know how to say it. I think if you're out in nature and you're looking at something and you look at I'll go back to the same thing. You're sitting on a hillside and you're looking at a bunch of beautiful trees and you say, oh, I know what that color is. That's from my color chart. That's 2 points viridian green, just a shot of cadmium lemon, and just a hair of red. I mean, if that's how you're thinking, I think you're thinking all backwards, okay? Because that's a technician's approach to painting, all right? That's not to say that there's not a lot of technical stuff that goes into painting, but if you have a simplified palette, for starters, okay, and you go back to the logic of what you're looking at, okay, you don't need a color chart in order to, you look, a color chart might be helpful because you get to learn how your paints all behave with one another, okay? But it's still not a practical, it's like, look, you can go to boot camp, but you're not really a soldier until somebody's shooting at you, you know? It's like, you know, once you're in the field, you know, it's a whole different thing, you know? So if, again, I go back to, I would teach, the color charts to me are a little ridiculous. I would teach a student how to see. Look at the sky. Yeah. What color's the sky? What color's the light? What color's that tree? How is the local color of that tree being affected by the light and by the shadow? You know, what is the relationship of that tree next to the tree next to it? You know, and then you have a limited palette. Well, you know, it's orange light hitting green leaves. You know, you figure out the value and you put it down. And if you know, again, if you know how your colors are all going to behave with one another, And what I mean by that is, you know that if purple and orange are opposites, correct? And mm-hmm. you put them together, you're going to create a tone, all right? So once you know all of those things, that green and red are going to create a neutral, that purple and orange are going to create a neutral. But if you want to create a warm neutral, you lean towards red. If you want to play a cool neutral, you lean towards blue. These things are, painting is all relative. You're not really painting what you see anyway, which, by the way, I could do an hour on that, okay? This idea that you're painting what you're seeing is ridiculous. You can't really paint what you see because you're only painting what you choose to see, you know?
Right.
It's when you look at a landscape painting, you go, oh, I'm just painting what I'm seeing. I hope not, because you're going to be out there the rest of your life, you know? You know, just for that one landscape, you're out there picking and choosing what you're choosing to look at to tell a bigger story as an artist, you know?
Right.
So yeah. I think color charts might be, to create color charts, I think is a waste of time. I know people do them. I know there's some very famous, successful artists who do them. I think it's kind of a waste of time.
Yeah. Michael Harding also typed in that, at that time, that he also thinks it's a waste of time. So we have three of us saying that it's kind of a waste of
right.
time. And when I do stand outside to mix paint, it's not so much, you know, that I'm creating some kind of a chart. It's more that I'm forcing myself to see past just local color into other colors and what's really there. And the best part is after I mix it up, I can walk right up to it and say, did I get it right?
I agree. Linda, yeah. Is Melanie the name of the person that sent that, asked that question?
Yes.
I am sure if you could go back in time and ask Vincent Van Gogh, do you do color charts? He'd say, what the hell is a color chart? I mean, you know. So,
you know. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to move on.
next question, thank you, is from Liz. Liz asks, what are the biggest mistakes a beginner makes in regard to hues?
Hughes.
Yeah, H-U-E-S. Color.
Well, I didn't say Howard Hughes.
Yeah, right.
I'm not exactly sure what the question means. Hughes. I'm not clear. I'm not clear what the definition of hue would be in regards to this question. You know what I'm saying? Do you want to help me with this?
Yeah, I'm not. Listen, Liz.
Yeah, Liz.
Hey, Liz, if you're out there still, kind of get a little more distinct with what you're asking around color hues, and I think that George and I could probably help you out a little bit more.
It's like you have to say the same thing over and over and over again because it needs to be said. Hues, color, values, everything that we're talking about, drawing, composition, edges, all of this stuff, In the end, this is all about observation, okay?
Yeah.
Again, if you look at a house that's white in the distance in the afternoon light, it's a white house and light is slamming into the house, okay? This references the Emil Gruppi thing, by the way, okay? And Gruppi was so smart at his colors were, like, always spot on, okay? And Gruppi was smart because he would say, okay, well, it's a blue sky, and it's orange light, but he knew if he put blue, you know, you can't really put blue in the white and make it look like it's warm, but he would take a touch of that cadmium lemon that's got a touch of blue in it, and he would mix it with a dab of white and a dab of orange and paint that, quote, white house, and it would look so correct to your eye because it was replicating exactly what was going on in nature, okay? The orange light with the white and that little touch of blue, you know, in the yellow, that's exactly what was going on in the color spectrum. If you can answer those questions to yourself, what is really going on in terms of the science of color, then you can paint with abandon because you really understand what's going on. Those are the questions you need to ask yourself.
Yeah. Liz typed in that,
I think I really meant values.
Yeah, so she thought, what are the biggest mistakes a beginner makes in regard to values? And I would
I would say the biggest mistake, the biggest mistake that a lot of, including myself, and I've been painting for decades, okay, is that a lot of times, and I eventually surrendered to it and my painting got a lot better. I think a lot of times we look at values and we say to ourselves, I can't tell the difference between that value and that value and that value and that value. I can only tell the obvious ones. I can only tell the difference between the very obvious ones. Well, the truth is, you're seeing it correctly from the very beginning. Most values are very, very, very close. That's why you can paint a completely believable landscape with screaming bright light in only four or five values, because most of the values, there's hundreds of them that are falling into the mid-range, you know? So I would say that to just accept the fact that most values are very, very, very close, I would do that by squinting at them, because when you squint at something, you'll notice that act of squinting takes away all the superfluous values, and you'll say, there's really only three or four values going on here that count, you know, that I really need. And then I would just look for the color temperature shifts inside of those values.
Right. As a beginner, my guidance would be to go out to Dakota Pastels or artessentials.com. Dakota Pastels has a really, really handy tri-folded value comp, if you want to call it that, which has red squares, and it has all this mathematics stuff on it. So if you're painting a certain size, small, it allows you to have a conversion to a larger canvas and what that larger canvas would be. Everything you need in this tri-folded thing. And then that red square, if you hold it up and look out at the scene on plein air, for the most part gets you to see black and white value. So that's why it's called a value comp. So if you're beginning, my guidance would be get yourself a value comp. And if you can find one in red and one in blue, that's even better. So I have one of each, and I still use it today because it, just to check to make sure I'm seeing what I'm seeing when I'm squinting. Because most of us, when I have beginner students, that's the first thing I try to teach them is values. And I have to have that value comp because they won't get it until I turn a color scene into a black and white scene by holding that value comp up. So if you're beginning with that, that might be your first step. So,
cool. All right.
Sounds good.
Switching gears a little bit here, an interesting question came in from Collie. And they write, I see George uses vertical strokes in the sky. Some artists are beginning to do this, but it still looks a little bit strange to me. What is the reason?
That's a great question. I have no answer to that. Yes, as a general rule, one would think that the sky goes side to side as opposed to up and down. I have, who asked that question?
Collie.
You troublemaker. I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer to it. You know, I sometimes, if I think I see stuff in the atmosphere that looks like it's going vertically, I kind of do it, you know. I have to tell you, every once in a while, I'll see a painting of mine where I did it, and it'll bug the hell out of me too. So I think it's interesting. I don't know the answer to that. I did a winter scene about a year ago, where some of it I did horizontally, and some of it I did vertically, the paint, and it was because I thought I saw in the atmosphere things kind of dancing around vertically. But, you know, now that I look at the painting, I'm like, I wished I hadn't have done that. But so I don't know the answer to that. I know Daniel Garber and guys like that used to do it sometimes. I think they did it just for design reasons. You know, I don't have a straight answer for that, you know? Yeah.
Cool. I thought it was very interesting kind of question. We don't get that, like.
I think it's a great question. It's a great question. I mean.
Yeah, maybe you're sometimes, considering the curvature of the Earth.
That's what I was
thinking. Yeah, no, but I know what they're saying is, like, sometimes, like, And sometimes, you know, it could be something as, it could be as dumb a reason as I'm painting a large painting outside and I'm getting tired of my arm going vertically, you know, and or horizontally. And I just decide to go vertically because, you know, I'm throwing my shoulder out from working so fast. You know, it could be a lot of reasons, you know, I don't know.
I think maybe it was the relationship of the stroke next to it.
Yeah, I'd like to make up some ridiculous reason, but the truth of it is...
Because.
Well, I meant to do that, like the Pee-wee Herman thing when he falls off his bike. I meant to do that. It could be a variety of reasons, and one of them could be that I was tired. You know, sometimes I think I see something, you know, but as a general rule, who the hell knows?
All right, thank you.
You got it.
Judy wants to know, how do you evaluate a night scene for values?
Oh, that's a great question. I've only done two, maybe nocturnes in my whole life. I keep saying I'm going to do them, and I never get around to it. I don't have an answer for that. I have stood, you know, my painting studio was, as Linda knows, she's been to the house, is a 3-car garage, right? And I open up the doors, you know.
Well, that's going to be our secret, George.
Yeah, no, it's a 3-car garage with north light. It's just wonderful, and I have all the fresh air in the world, and I don't get sick from the toxic smells of all the turpentines and everything because I've got the doors open all the time. But I have sat at night in that chair and looked out over the valley, and tried to paint these things in my head, and I noticed that a lot of nocturnes that are painted by artists are sometimes, they have more value shifts in them, and they seem brighter to me than they would really be in reality. Because I think nocturnes are just nearly impossible. That's probably why I've never done them. I have no clue. I would imagine that, in a real nocturne, you know, your value, I would imagine a lot of it is just really, really, really dark, you know. If you could find a way to feature something, you know, like, I remember years ago when I was a kid in Vermont, the sky was so full of stars. I was with a couple of friends. We were walking along at night. The stars were so bright, we could literally see our own shadows cast on the ground, which I thought was like in LA, that would never happen in a million years, you know. Because of the stuff in the air, you know, but then you're near a big city, but, you know, I don't know. That's a great, I don't know enough about nocturnes, you know, to say.
Okay. Thank you.
I would say plenty of black paint would be my,
Another question from Judy. How do you maintain the vibrancy in your color when adding white to change the value? I find white often dulls the colors.
That is a great question. That is a phenomenal question. Okay. Okay. There's a dichotomy that goes on in painting. All right. The instinct is to add white to a color in order to lighten it. All right. But if painting outdoors on a warm day, white, the dichotomy is this: white lightens colors, but white is the coldest of all of our pigments, okay? So of all the pigments on the palette, white is the coldest. So therefore, when we are painting outdoors with warm light, let's say, and we want to lighten a color and we add white, we're cooling the color. We're not just dulling it, we're cooling it. So therefore, it never looks right. The only way in nature we're adding white paint to a color and lightening it where it won't look wrong is if you are painting in a situation where your light is predominantly cool, meaning you're outside on a high overcast day where there's lots of clouds, but the sun isn't really coming through. You know, you have a high overcast. In that case, your shadows get warm, they don't get cool. So it's a complete opposite of what's going on. Your shadow, hold on, is everything okay? Okay, my wife just walked in. your shadows are the warmest and your light is the coldest, then you can absolutely, to your heart's content, lighten colors with white, because that's what's really going on. They're getting lighter and they're getting cooler, you know, but, and the shadows, it's the flip. The shadows are getting warmer. On a warm day, it's the exact opposite. The light is warm, the shadows are cool. So you cannot add white to those colors in order to lighten them. If you are going to add white, or if you must add white, you must also add some of the light of the sun. So I wouldn't look at the sun and burn my retinas out, but you can look at what the sun is doing to various things. Like, what's the sun doing hitting a white object? What's the sun, like if the sun's hitting birch trees, you know, or aspen trees, what is the color? We know basically the local color of that tree is essentially white, okay? But is it a yellowy white? Is it an orangey white? You know, what is happening? And if I was going to introduce white, which is I would do that very, very sparingly, I would also have to introduce the light of the sun. So if light is hitting green trees, those greens are going to go probably, if the sun is a bright yellow, like if the light is, let's say, yellow in color temperature, you know, or in hue, let's say, that some of that yellow would get into the green. So I would introduce, I mean, I'm just speaking theoretically, you know, I would introduce some yellow to brighten that green as opposed to white. I might add a touch of white to knock the yellow down, if that makes sense, if it's getting too yellowy, because the white will cool the yellow, and maybe that white and yellow combination with that green, again, this is all theory, should work for you. But white as a lightening agent, if your light is warm, is not what you do. You can, again, I'll say it again, on a high overcast day, you can add all the white you want to lighten things because the light is cool and you're replicating what's going on in nature. You'll notice, like Richard Schmid, for instance, Richard Schmid paints lots of paintings with high overcast days, and they're beautiful paintings, but he's actually lightening his colors with white because that's what's going on in nature, you know? So anyway.
Okay, cool, thank you. We have a few seconds left, or a few minutes here. I'm gonna combine a couple questions. A lot of folks are asking, first, can you say Groupie's book title again?
It's called Groupie on Color. He wrote three books. One was called Groupie on Painting, which is excellent. One was called the other one was called Brushwork. And the last book he wrote before he passed was called Groupie on Color. I believe that's the best of the three. It's all about color. And there really are just forgotten color theories in this book. He was a master. It's been out of print for quite a while, and it's probably difficult to get. And, you know, it might cost $100 or something, but I'm telling you that that book and John F. Carlson's book, those are probably the only two books you ever really need to read. I mean, I've read them all, but the Groupie book is so clear, because Groupie was a, you know, I know people who, there's a woman by the name of Claudia Post. She knew Groupie very well. And he was sort of an old school guy, you know, spoke in cryptic sentences, you know what I mean? So he was a kind of a no nonsense guy, the way he wrote. He wrote very, very clear. So it's not a lot of flowery nonsense. It's almost like talking to a longshoreman, you know, about painting, which I find refreshing, because I don't want to hear a lot of jive. I just want the answer. You know what I mean? You know, so anyway.
Any other book recommendations or resources where people can find more information on color?
Well, there's a lot of good books. I mean, I think Groupies is the best. I mean, look, again, I'm not trying to shamelessly plug my book. My book is definitely, I think, helpful. I would like to write an entire book just on color. I think Edgar Payne's book is terrific. I think, but the groupie one is the one I always go back to because it's just so succinct. It's just so clear. And he explains how paint mixtures behave with other paint mixtures and how important it is to just observe what's going on. I'm telling you, once your observations become keen, you know, and it just takes time, you know, don't beat yourself up. It takes decades, you know, and enjoy the journey, enjoy the process. But, you know, as you're observing what's going on around you, how to paint these things won't be a mystery anymore, you know, because you'll understand what you're seeing, you know. You don't need a million words to be a great novelist, you know. You only need to know what you want to say, you know. And look, my favorite writer of all was John Steinbeck, who wrote very clearly, you know, not overly flowery. You know what I mean? Steinbeck could say more with a few words than a lot of people could say with 1,000 words. So if you as a painter are looking at something and you are able to process it, okay, I'm going to, if I have a minute, I'd like to say this. Stop looking at things as objects. Look at them as shapes and edges and color and value, and paint them in your mind as you're looking at them, you know, and that's how you will begin to observe things as an artist, observe things as a painter, and then is when you will get a better grasp as to how to paint these things as only you could paint them and not the way others would paint them.
Perfect.
Cool, thank you. Okay. Let's get safe to wrap this one up. Do you guys
Let's wrap it up.
The things you have coming up, workshops, the next art chat, what's going on? What's coming up?
Well, George
With
has
me, I'm not doing anything. No, I'm not doing
right.
a damn thing.
Uh-huh.
I'm retiring.
You're done.
Once I hang up, that's it, I'm done.
I quit.
Get the guitar out and the heck with it, right?
Right, that I'm done with this painting nonsense.
Yeah. Actually, George is going to have a show starting May 1st, right, George?
May 1st.
In Youngstown, Ohio?
At the Butler Institute of American Art, I'm having a retrospective.
Yeah.
Yes,
so
of nearly 70 paintings.
There you go. So, and that starts March 1st to June 12th, I think is the dates, right?
Yes. Yeah, it's going to be a beautiful show, and it really is. It's like 70 of the best paintings I've done, which I'm very, very proud.
So.
And yeah, it's going to be a great show. And there's some huge paintings. Sometimes I look at them and I'm like, boy, that was crazy. You know, like, what was I thinking lugging that thing outside? You know,
yeah. Yeah. Any workshops coming up that you'll be doing?
You know, I've got the plein air convention next week. I'm the opening act. I'm doing a painting on stage. Those things are always fun because, you know, you're painting in an auditorium in front of 500 people. That's exactly how I paint when I go into the woods. I bring 500 of my close personal friends with me. And, you know, and they make rude comments as I'm working, you know. Call that a tree. That doesn't look like a rock. Anyway, so
that's scheduled workshops.
No, I have no workshop schedule right now because I just get so busy. You know, I lead two lives. I'm also a writer, so.
Right. Okay, so I think that's for next art chat will be with, I think.
With me, yeah. They're all with me from here on
that's
out.
That's right, next week we'll have George, no, I'm kidding. Yeah. Next art is May, yeah, I'm trying to count how many women we have. One, two, three, four, five lovely women joining us. They're women artist mentors on May 18th. So Deborah Kearse, Helen Beecham, Kim, I'm going to mess up this name, Minicello, something like that. Sorry, Kim, if you're listening, you can correct me next month. And Carrie Waller and Maria Bennett-Hock will be joining us to talk about mentoring and how they formed a group to support one another and how you can form a group of artists around you that'll be really, really supportive. So that'll be a really nice talk, and that's on May 18th. So.
All right. Well, we'll see you guys at the next Art Chat, hopefully. And thank you so much, Linda and George, for being here today.
Yeah, thank you, George.
Blast. I had a blast. And Linda, I hope to see you in Ohio.
I will. Well, we're going to make a really, we'll be up there, George.
All right.
I may have to mosey on up myself.
Yeah. Let us,
all right, great.
You
and
can
if
send
not,
me a note on, let me know when your dates that you're going to be up there so that I can make sure I get up there to see you.
All right.
You won't
be able to miss me. I'll be wearing a pink carnation. So.
We're getting a few thank yous.
That's it? Just a pink carnation?
Yeah. And a tutu.
Not going.
No, you don't know. No, not a pretty sight. Not a pretty sight.
I'm just kidding.
I can only say
that.
Oh, my gosh. All right.
This degraded quickly.
We're officially wrapping this up.
All right. Bye. God bless. Thank you.
Bye, George.
Hey, everybody. Cheer up. Okay. All right.
I was just going to say, we are getting quite a few thank yous coming in through the question section, so I'll pass those on from our audience to you guys. So thanks again for doing this. Everyone's very appreciative, and we'll have to do it again.
I can't wait. All right. Bye, everybody.
Everyone. Have a good day.
Bye.